brothers and sisters, in Jesus' holy name, amen. And amen. Building my testimony. Building my testimony. We are all under construction or restoration. Some are under construction, and I consider those under construction, those that came, for example, to organization like this and they never met the Lord before. So as soon as you meet the Lord start a reconstruction in you, because we were of a different shape. The Word of God says that in the book of Genesis chapter 1 that the earth or the world was shapeless. It was a void. It was everything out of order. That is the things before they are created, before they are in order. With us, because of the sin, it happens the same. The Lord, when He finds us, because again, we don't find the Lord, it's the Lord that finds us, He finds us without shape, void, with a void, and without everything is out of order. No, there is no progress. So for those that come to the Lord in that stage of, I don't know God, and I start hearing about God in the body of Messiah Christian Church or any other church or in Rimar during my rehabilitation, for those it starts a process of construction or reconstruction. And for those that already met the Lord before and by any chance they abandoned the Lord, the circumstances of life that can be led by drugs, alcohol or whatever, or many other circumstances, those it starts a process of restoration, to restore what once was in store or was in order, was built up nice. This is also the process of a spiritual restoration that demands discipline and dedication from an individual. The discipline of your restoration or reconstruction, it is not about me that I have to take care of your restoration or construction. The discipline does not come from me and does not come the dedication either. It comes from you. It takes you to be an individual, to you to take care of your reconstruction or your restoration. Because it's between you and God. It's always between you and God. My relationship with God, I cannot bring anybody into my relationship with God. In other words, I can't tell my pastor, Luis, look, you need to take care of my spiritual life. And demand him to take care of my spiritual life. Demand him to pray for my sins, for the forgiveness of my sins, for instance. It can't be. It has to be you, or it has to be me that have to take care of that spiritual area of my life. The process of spiritual restoration demands discipline and dedication, where the smaller of the details of its process are relevant, important, and of a bigger priority. Pastor Dario, he always taught me something that is very important. There is people that they told me during my lifetime. There is people that they told me maybe just a sentence. That sentence I have the habit to carry with me, if it makes sense, and if it impacts my life. Pastor Dario always tells me. I also use it, but I know that a sentence I took from him, which is in the small details, is where you find the difference. The details, it is where you find the difference. That's why I wrote that where the smaller of the details of its process are relevant, important, and of a bigger priority. Today we will see and contemplate a God of details. For those that think that perfectionism is bad, you cannot misplace perfectionism with the details. Details doesn't have to do with perfectionism. Details have to do with excellence. And you could hide, or you can hide, many of you can hide, especially those with more years in the church or in the ministry, you can hide and say, no, but my level of excellence or my approach about excellence, it's different from yours. But it does not work like that. Excellence is excellence. Excellence is when you give your all. And if you give your all, that will be your excellence, and your excellence will be the best. Because excellence goes with a companionship of love, of dedication. It's not just excellence, oh no, I'm going to do my best. If you try to do your best and you think that you are applying excellence, yet you are not putting a bit of love, like the advertising of Levi's. You know the brand Levi's, né? Levi Strauss, huh? Was an advertising in the 90s that used to say, you must put a little bit of blue in everything you do. So the advertising of the Christianhood, where we belong, it should be, you must put a bit of love in everything you do. Everything you do. So if you intend to do something that you say, okay, I'm going to input my excellence into this, but yet you don't put love, you don't put dedication, and you don't put attention in the small details, you are doing nothing, you are doing for you are not doing for God. And we will see today a God of excellence, a God of details. Yet He is perfect. We cannot be perfect, but we can be excellent. We cannot be perfect yet because we cannot be God. Even though when we become perfect, our perfection won't be according with the perfection of God. Because the perfection of God walks with His power, with all the attributes of God, His mighty power. Today we will look into the Temple of Solomon in order to apply a few spiritual rules into our lives. For that, first of all, we go to 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 11 to 13. 1 Kings chapter 6, verses 11 to 13. And the word of God reads like this, as follows. Now the word of the Lord came to Solomon concerning this house that you are building. If you will walk in my statutes and obey my rules and keep all my commandments and walk in them, then I will establish my word with you, which I spoke to David your father. And I will dwell among the children of Israel and will not forsake my people Israel. 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 11 to 13. Again, I read. Now the word of God came to Solomon. The word of God came to whom?
Solomon.
Concerning this house that you are building. What house he was building? Eh? The temple. Who started the process of the temple was whom? The King David, the father of Solomon. We must have this in the back of your mind. The process of the construction of the temple started with the King David, the father of Solomon. If you, concerning this house that you are building, if you will walk in my statutes and obey my rules and keep all my commandments and walk in them, then I will establish my word with you, which I spoke to David your father. And I will dwell among the children of Israel, and I will not forsake my people Israel. Point one is walking in his statutes. Statutes are not rules. Statutes are not commandments. What is status all about? Status. Huh? Status. If it's not rules, are not commandments, what it is?
No.
Statutes. Huh?
No.
Huh?
No.
Law? Hallelujah. Statutes, it's about the law of God. If you abide with my law, if you try to fulfill the law, if you observe the law, this is what God is saying. Then I will, what? What he says? Because he repeats something, he says something after something, but he says, walk in my status, then I will dwell among the children of Israel. But you must observe my law. You must observe my commandments. Did Jesus left us a commandment, yes or no? Huh? Huh? Yes, which is? Love God above all things and your neighbor as yourself. Can we love God above all things? It is easy to love God above all things? Or it is difficult to love God above all things? You know why it's difficult? Because we always have something that we love. We come to church, we hear about God. As the brother says, this is I don't like the way he said emotional. It touches our emotions. I really don't want the worship to touch your emotions. I beg you, don't. I want the worship to be, and this is not about making you joyfully and have a good time. This is not about that. This is about an experience with the Spirit of God that He can change you in that specific moment that you have an interaction with His glory, that it changes the whole perspective. It changes everything. The statutes of the Lord, observe them. You come to church, you enjoy with the Lord, you have the process, a spiritual process with the Lord, and you, in this very moment, you say that the Lord is the most important thing for your life. You embrace everything that the Lord has for you, but then when you go outside, when you sit in your desk, when you sit in your car, when you start moving, when you sit in your factory, and I'm addressing situations that we are all familiarized with, when you sit in your shop or start organizing your day, suddenly out of the blue, there is things that start popping up from our hearts. The Bible says, Jesus says, in fact, in the Bible, of course, that our heart, it's a treasure, has a good treasure and a bad treasure. The tendency is that we allow the bad treasure, we allow us to take things out of the bad treasure. Because we treasure things in our heart that they are good and that they are bad. Many of us, we are not able to treasure the good things in the treasure of our heart. We treasure the bad things. We collect the stones. The King David collected 5 stones. I don't know if that is bad or good, but in the end of the day, one thing is for sure. If he is going to hit the Goliath with 1 stone, why collect 5 stones? He could collect only 1 if he's going to hit that 1 in the forehead of Goliath. Yet he picked up 5 stones. Maybe that was the insecurity of the King David. Maybe that was the insafetiness of the King David. He was insecure with himself, so he could not pick up 1. Maybe heard the Spirit of God. The Bible doesn't mention, but maybe heard the Spirit of God saying, "You will hit them in the forehead," because everything was so perfect aligned with the will of God that in the end of the day, maybe heard God telling him, "You know what? You're going to hit the forehead of Goliath with 1 stone, but he collect another 4. Maybe that was a symbol of his insecurity. And people, many times, we with our insecurities, we are able to pick up all the little stones that are on the way. You know, the little stones, those little things that approach us during the day that you collect. That harsh word that the brother told you. And instead of you forgive, you pick up the stone and you keep it in your pocket. That discussion that you had with a sister, you pick up that stone and you put in the pocket. That thing that you heard that you didn't like from your husband or from your wife, and you pick up the stone and you put in your pocket. And we go with full pockets into the lives, into our Christian path. And we should be entitled to leave the stones behind and allow us to walk freely. Well, a person that walks with stones in the pockets, either in the front, either in the back, in the sides, and then depend on the pair of trousers we wear, it will be difficult for us to walk with stones in our pockets. But people sometimes, they go through life with that because they are not able to forgive. And when we are not able to forgive, we pick up those little stones and we put in our pockets. And we need to be entitled to here or there or outside these doors. We need to be entitled to what we confess here, what we experience here, we must take outside and try at least to put in practice. Concerning even more than ever the pacts you do with the Lord. Because you can't say that you go outside then you won't sin. That's impossible. You will live an entire lie. If you think that you go outside just because you had a hell of an experience with the Spirit of God and then you go outside and you just, oh no, now from now on I won't sin no more. Ah, you will sin. Just the fact that you have that thought, that is already sin. Because it makes you with a sense of perfection. If you walk in my statutes, I wrote point 1, walking in his statutes, observing his law, the law that is in the word of God. Love God above all things and love your neighbor as yourself. Basically, Jesus was saying, if you are not able to love yourself, you won't be able to love others. If you can't take care of yourself, you cannot take care of others. Taking care of yourself, it's what it shows that in fact you love yourself when you take care of yourself. It speaks about everything, the way you dress, the way you bath, the way you take care of yourself. Basically is that. What you read, do you know that? What you eat, what you read, if you do a bit of exercise or not, and many other things. It's not just about the way I look, Because if it was about the way we look, it will be easy, because many disguise, they have the disguise of the way I look. I look like this, so it means that I'm okay. It's not like that. That's why in Rimar organization, when the people come to rehab, it's very easy to trick the people, to trick the leaders many times. Why? Because you can suddenly become more fat, more chubby, you look much better, suddenly you start dressing much better, because then you have a hygienic life much in order, and then it's easy to say, no, I'm fine. But the importance or the relevance is not how do you look outside, but how do you look inside? Because God wants your inside. This will perish. Doesn't mean that we won't take care of ourselves. That's why I say it's the inclusion of all the areas of our lives that it makes you love yourself. Then you are ready to love other people. This for us that we live in the New Testamentary era, we still live in the New Testamentary era. For us, it applies: love God above all things and your neighbor as yourself. Jesus basically said, I fulfilled the law, because he never broke it. The Bible says so. He never broke the law. He fulfilled the law. But as I fulfilled the law, I will compress the Ten Commandments into one. Love God above all things. Everything. It's saying basically, give it all. If you say your life is ease, your life must be ease, not partial. Not it's your life, but I need this area because I'm not safe. Again, I go to the stones. My life is yours, but I have to keep this stone on me or with me. Maybe we don't address that as an insecurity, but it is an insecurity. I need a saving. I need something. I need a backup. Come on, really? If you engage with the author of faith, the creator of the universe, let's not reduce God to the creator of heavens and earth. Nah, the creator of the universe, of everything that exists. If you engage with him, you'd really need a backup plan. What is the most powerful entity in the universe? Nothing can compare to him, and yet we still need our backup plan. You know what we are doing? Thank you, Sipo. We are reducing God to a little thing. He exists. I believe in him. Jesus died for me, but I don't know what can happen tomorrow. I know what can happen tomorrow. I'm under the hand of God. I might not understand many things that come to my life, but God always gives the escape. Oh, pastor, don't you have insecurities? And I have too many. I just don't say it. I have too many. I just don't leave them. Don't apply them. Don't put them in progress. But I have too many. And then I hold steadfast to the Lord. And I say, I have to go with you. And I have to go with you. And I have to go with you. Because I have no one to trust. But I have too many. But I don't go out to the corners of the world expressing to everybody, not even with my leadership, that, oh, you know what, this is happening to my life. No, I learned to count in God and only in him, knowing that he will have the escape for every single situation as much as I am under his statutes. Point two, obey his rules. If you walk with my statutes and obey my rules, if you walk in my laws and obey my rules, and obey my rules. Obedience is something very important in the Christian life. We have the tendency to disobey. How we disobey? Sin by itself is already disobedience to God, isn't it? Amen or no amen? Huh? And we sin continually, isn't it? Huh? Not continually, but we sin often. We are not counting our sins, because we should not count the sins, we should count the blessings. In order for us to understand how God is merciful, how God is a father. Yet the sins, we must observe them, not count them, in order for the devil to don't gain advantage and condemn you with me. But we must observe them in order to put them before the Lord and say, here are my sins, Lord, forgive me because I've been sinning in this and that area. But obedience is very difficult. We know that to obey God, it's a high level, it's a high standard. But you know, sometimes we think that I must obey God and only God, and I shall not obey man. You know, when you have men of God that were placed in your life to guide you, to be in leadership of you, on top of you. If you disobey them, you are actually disobeying God. For that you can go to the, we don't go there, but you can write down, we can go to the book of Romans chapter 13, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, it's Romans chapter 13 that speaks about authority. You can mark your Bible and read it, read the whole chapter. It's a chapter that you don't need much understanding to understand. You don't need that. You just need to read the first few verses. You will immediately you engage with what I'm trying to tell you here. Immediately you will engage with that. Obedience. You obey men of God. You are obeying God directly, because God directly. We are not able to obey, because of His level of perfection, His level of excellence. His absence of sin, His absence of death, His absence of failure, His absence of mistake and error. It's totally perfect. There is no shade of variation. He cannot change. So for us to obey God directly in a high performance or standard, it is very difficult. But sometimes it's difficult for us to obey men, but we hide behind the fact that, oh, my accountability is towards God, not any man. You are completely wrong. In the Bible, you go through the Bible. If you read all the Bible, I don't know, but if you read portions of the Bible, you will see that God always uses men. He uses always men to set free the people, to redeem the people. In fact, to redeem the people, He uses a man. Jesus was a man. Let's not forget about that. He was God made man. He was as powerful without, in the shape of a man or without the shape of man, he had the same power. He just decided to reduce Himself to that, to what we are here, in order for the perfect could be sacrificed, the second Adam, as it is written in the Bible, in the book of Hebrews. By one man that sin enters in the world, by another man sins go out of the world. Obedience, it's very important. Obedience. God says to Solomon, obey my rules. Point three, keep His commandments. Now the commandments. It's commandments, it's like commands. You can't do this, you can't do that. It's beyond rule. There is rules that can be broken. Commandments, God doesn't want them to be broken. So God says, keep my commandments. It's not even saying to obey my commandments. It's to keep them. In other words, the commandments is also for us, applies that the commandments is the word of God. We must have the word of God in our heart more than just a book in our hands. Many have the word of God in their hands, and we can carry the word of God everywhere in our hands. But do we have the word of God in our hearts? Who saw the movie The Book of Eli? Huh? The Book of Eli is a very good movie of Denzel Washington, one of my favorite actors. And Denzel Washington, he goes through the movie. It's totally biblical, the movie, because there is a group of people, the days were, it's like the world is collapsing, there is not much people in the world. The people are eating each other even, and they must defend themselves. And there's a Washington have the only Bible in the world. And there is a group of men that want to steal that Bible. And they finally did it. They finally stole the Bible. The problem is that the Bible was in, how do you call in English, Braille. Braille, I mean, it's the same in Portuguese, Braille. The Bible was in Braille. In other words, only blind people could read that book. So it was useless for that guy. Was useless. But then Denzel Washington was what? In the end of the movie, we see that he was blind. So then in the end of the movie, much better than ever, he didn't need the book to read anymore. Why? Because he memorized the book, the entire book he memorized in his mind. When he memorized in his mind, he's saying that he memorized in his heart. In a few moments of the movie, it looks like that apparently he lost something. But then when he finally found a group of people that would help him, he understood that he never lost, because what he thought that was lost was already within him. So the Word of God has to be like that. It's not just a carrier of a book, but has to be commandments that are within us. that we know without reading the book. We know without opening the book. And with this saying, I'm not saying that, no, you shall not read the Bible anymore if you know a lot of the Bible. No. What I'm saying is that whatever you read, it must be printed in the center of your heart. Point four, walk in His commandments. Keep His commandments, walk in His commandments. Now, it's saying what? Put in practice My commandments. Not just keep them, but now you must put it in practice. Again, the commandments in our context of today, it's the whole Word of God, from Genesis to Revelation, the compilation of 66 books. Remember that the Bible is not a book. The word Bible, it means library, okay? And because it's a compilation of 66 books. So it's all the books that count. So all those books, now he's saying that it contains the commandments of God. So now he says, don't just keep them with you, but walk in them. Share them also. Because many we are able to receive, but we are not able to give. As much as you receive and you give, God will give you more. God won't share revelation after revelation if you are not able to share the revelation. When I start preaching in the devotionals in Rimar and so forth, and in the church that I met Rita, every time that I have a revelation, I would push myself and do everything I could in my hand to share that revelation with somebody, because of that principle, because I knew that if I share this with somebody, God will give me much more. He will open His heart. He will open the tap of revelation for you to be always with revelation, in revelation, and revelation. Point five is instructions given to a man. Instructions given to a man, which I spoke in the verse 12, in the end of the verse 12, the last sentence, which I spoke to David, your father. See what I'm saying? It is not that God, it's God Almighty, God All-Powerful. He could just say, and he could not do that because God doesn't have our pride. Because pride is also a sin. So God, He won't say, you know what, I'm God, I'm the best of all. You must do as I say. No. He even uses somebody that already started the process. That person already was addressing Solomon before he dies. He addressed Solomon to do something. You must build the temple. You must continue building the temple. See, the instructions of a man wasn't just the submission to what God is telling, but God Himself is saying, submit what I gave to your father David. Consider what I'm giving to your father David. That was the previous authority that in the end of the day was the authority over Solomon. So receive, consider what he told you, consider. Consider the legacy. Consider what he comes behind you in order for you to be ahead also. But consider what comes behind you always. Which I spoke with your father David. Point six is God promises. God promises. And I wrote in bold letters a phrase that says, God promises under conditions, always under conditions. I call God of the if you, I will. It's the God of if you, I will. If you, I will. If you, I will. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, right? What it says? Go, make disciples from all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, keep the commandments that I've given to you, and I will be with you until the end of times, or until the end of the ages. So is God of if you, I will. Here is the same. And I will dwell, because you, God is basically saying, to compress this in our English, God is telling him, my brother, if you walk in my statutes, obey my rules, and keep all my commandments, and walk in them, then I will establish my word with you, which I spoke to David your father, and I will dwell among the children of Israel. So every after every instruction of God, there is a promise. Always God promises something. You do like this, I will act like that. He wants to say that the consequences of your actions will be this. The good consequences of your actions, of course, will be this. In many cases, you find in the Bible, especially the Old Testament, of course, God saying that if you behave this way, then I will destroy you. I will annihilate you. I will bust your generation. I will cut your generation. And you have many of those as saying that the bad consequences of your actions will be bad. God promises under conditions. Conclusion. The small details will make the difference, and the Solomon Temple is full of details. As I encourage you to read all chapter 6 of 1 Kings, I encourage you to also read just that chapter. Romans chapter 13, as I told you, and also I encourage you to read just the chapter 6. You will see that the full amount of details that God places in the construction of the temple. Of chapter 6 of 1 Kings, in order for you to engage in the perfection of God's plan, and as is part of His character, the details of everything He does. In the Old Testament, the temple, it would have been plundered several times and would have been totally destroyed by Nabucodonosor II of Babylon in 586 before Christ. After 2 years of siege to Jerusalem, its treasures would have been taken to Babylon, and thus began the period that is conventionally called Babylonian exile or captivity in Babylon, in Jewish history, of course. And it happens. And it is in the Bible too. In other hand, God promises a reconstruction in the Old Testament. The temple was destroyed, but God promises a reconstruction. And what God says? In Haggai chapter 2, verse 9, what God says? Says, the later glory of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in its this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. The glory of the former house. Today I was reading this and I thought to myself, I wonder if he was speaking about Jesus. Because Jesus, when he went to the temple and even he saw the people selling stuff in the temple, he didn't like what he saw. But eventually, for the Jewish people, Haggai is speaking about the temple that then was reconstructed. That then, for the Jewish people, for the Sadducees and Pharisees, was very confused for them, because Jesus said that I will destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Who knows this passage? Huh? I will destroy the temple and rebuild in 3 days. So the mind of the Sadducees, Pharisees, the Jewish people was like this one. Now he knocks the head very hard, because it took us 53 years to build the temple back to its shape. And now he wants to destroy and build it back. He was speaking about himself as the temple. That's why I say that I look to this Haggai chapter 2 verse 9 and I say, I wonder if this is not a messianic prophecy. I wonder if the glory of the former house, the glory of the other house, the next house, is not Jesus Christ Himself. He will be rising again. He rose again from dead. But applying to the preaching in the sermon we are having today, it is also what happens with us. Sometimes we need to be destroyed in order to be rebuilt into new levels of humbleness. I'm pretty sure that with the religion so intrinsic on the bloodline of the Jewish people of those days, the Sadducees, Pharisees, and so forth, I'm pretty sure that when they reconstruct the temple, for them was a different thing. They gave a different value because of what they lost and what they gained back. It was different, for sure. So God also wants us to improve and extend our vision and capacity of accommodate levels of service, as He says in His Word, enlarge the place of your tent and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes, For you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolate cities. This is written in the book of Isaiah, chapter 54, verse 2 and 3. Enlarge the place of your tent, the symbol of the tabernacle, the symbol of the temple. And God says, enlarge the place of your tent. Let the curtains of your habitations to be stretched out. We don't like to be stretched. We are the temple of God, but we don't like to be stretched. We don't like to enlarge our tent. It is too much work for us in many occasions. It is too much work to change things that we are accommodated already. Change, I learned in this ministry, Rimar, that change is always for good. Mudança, crescimento, yeah. Change is growth. We learned in this ministry. When you change, even from one place to another, change, it always brings with growth. And that's why we don't want many times to change, because in order for you to change, it's not sometimes just about changing a place, changing an occupation, a function. It's about your growth. It's about, it will shake structures in your life that they were already accommodated. So when God says, enlarge the place of your tent and let the curtains of your habitations to be stretched out, do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes, for you will spread abroad to the right, to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolated cities. God is calling us to extend the way we think, for example. He's calling us to extend the way we think, act, and walk. Is when he says, extend your tent. Extend your tent. Because we are the temple of the Spirit of God, but the temple of the Spirit of God, he operates in the same area that even the devil operates. It is not in the entire body. He operates in your mind. Then your body will respond according with what is in your mind. If you have a vision of an eagle, you are always able to see the better picture, and you are always able to see prey to hunt. You are always able to see the bigger view of your life. If you have a vision of a chicken, what you see, it's nothing less than a pole to the ground. You won't see nothing else. So when God says, enlarge the place of your tent, he's saying, again, he's saying, as I wrote, God is calling us to extend the way we think, to change the way we think. And in the church you find people that they're not the brain, but the mentality, not the brain, but the mentality is reduced. In other words, you might have a mentality that you can extend your mentality to, let's put it like that, to 90%, 60%, 70%, it depends. But yet, you prefer to think with your 10%. Because you don't want much trouble, you don't want to. Because every growth, it demands, besides the change, it demands sacrifice. And we don't like sacrifice. We like to accommodate ourselves in our little cushy world. And I'm fine like this, everything is under control. Because at the end of the day, as I heard in a sermon today in the morning, we like to have everything under control. The pastor even said that, and he's a pastor of Rimar, and he said that in Rimar, when we ask, so how is that subject going? We have the habit in Rimar to say, no, everything is under control. And then he said, when a man says that everything is under control, it means that everything is out of control. Mainly is like that, because we have nothing under control. God has everything under control. Then we are just objects of his grace, objects of his plan. We are like pawns in the life. We are like chess pawns in the stage of life that God moves us around the way he wants, where he wants, and how he wants. God is calling us to extend the way we think, act, and walk. God is not calling us for mediocrity, yet to radicalism. He's not calling us to have the mindset of a bird, a little bird that is just content with a little bit of food and a little bit of water. No, God is calling us to be an eagle that flies high. The eagle. You know, one of the characteristics of the eagle is when the eagle achieves a certain age, an advanced age, the eagle, it climbs, it flies to the highest peak of the mountain, and she takes every feather of her body. and she takes the nails of her, how do you call it, paws. She takes the nails of the paws and then she broke the beak until she becomes without a beak. If that eagle, for instance, have 30 years old, she is there, that is called the reborn of the eagle, because then she is there for a few months hidden, that everything will grow back, but will grow back in certain strength that she will be younger 30 years, but not just younger 30 years, but she will be able to live another 30 years. But it demands the sacrifice of it. And then you can see the input or the importance that the eagle has. And God in His Word also uses a lot the eagle as a model. You must be like eagles. And we must be like eagles. God is not calling us for mediocrity, yet to radicalism. Now the Lord said to Abraham, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. He didn't give any explanation. Oh, we like so many explanations. There is people that they like explanations for everything. They demand you an explanation. They demand from the leader, from the pastor, from the responsible, a explanation. There is things that they don't demand explanation. They demand obedience. In the meantime that you demand explanation, you should be giving obedience and not waiting for explanations. Because when you wait for explanations, many times you disobey just because somebody did not give you an explanation. There is no explanation. Then sometimes we have to give explanations, of course, even if you don't ask. Then the person that is entitled to explain, we need to give explanations. Yesterday, we arrived very late to Malbarton. Three men were there working, of course. I had to give an explanation. They must understand that the day was very difficult, very rough. And the ministry where they belong, the body of Christ, where they are part of the body, was suffering a bit of pain. So in their case also, they suffered a little bit because they were there. And my intentions were to go earlier and to open everything and this and that. But because of the ministry, so when I arrived, what did I did? I gave an explanation. This happens, this is happening, and this. And then everybody, oh, that's why we were here so long. That's why, so now it's understandable. They demand an explanation. Now they deserve an explanation, not demand, they deserve an explanation. For them also to understand that, okay, I suffered this while, but things were happening much worse than this. So now I understand, I can deal with it because I'm part of the body too. And nobody likes that the body suffers. I don't like at least. Radicalism. And Abraham, he was what? He was radical. He packed his stuff and he went. You know what, God? Wait a minute. No. I'm well here. Now you are telling me to go there. No. Doesn't work like that. You need to give me an explanation. But the fact states that people, they need explanations for everything. But yet God asks, thank you, Sipo, again, radicalism. And as usual, after instruction from the Lord, it follows a promise. God did not just say to Abraham to go. After that, he gave a promise. He said, because you go, because you obey my instruction, and I will make of you a great nation. And I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Genesis chapter 12, verse 2 and 3. The first of the instructions is 12:1. Okay? This is a promise that also falls on us as we are heirs or co-heirs in Christ Jesus. This many Christians, they are not able to see the bigger picture. The ones that are in Christ Jesus are made new creatures, says the Bible in the book of John, isn't it? Are made new creatures, but the ones that are in Christ Jesus, we also inherit this. We inherit this. That's why many times I say to people, be careful when you curse a man of God, be careful when you say things to a man of God that you shouldn't say. Be careful when you think and say. Be careful, because what the Bible says, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. You know, I like to bless people that I can see on their lives that they are men of God or women of God. Me and Rita, we have the habit of that. And sometimes people are in our house and we accumulate in our house and they say, no, you are a blessing. We say, no. You are blessing us. And we say, no, we are not blessing you. We are blessing us, because your presence here makes us being more blessed than you. Don't think that you have the blessing for you. We have the blessing for us because of this, because of the depth of belief that I have in this scripture. I accommodate a man of God or a woman of God, we serve, then what happened? We will have the bigger blessing of all. Because the Bible says, I will bless you, I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. You dishonor a man of God, a woman of God, you dishonor a Christian that is already with a high commitment to the Lord, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This is a promise that also falls on us, as we are co-heirs or heirs in Christ Jesus. That says the Bible in Romans 8:17 says, and if children, then heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Well, what is this all about? We gain the blessing of Abraham. We will be blessed as Abraham. The blessing of Abraham will be upon us through Christ Jesus, because he's from the lineage of Abraham. But also comes another one. Provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Those that suffer here for the sake of Christ, they will be glorified with Christ. And we don't like to suffer. We like a gospel that brings you glory and just glory, joy and just joy, prosperity and just prosperity, flux of victory after flux of victory. But what it says the Bible, provided we suffer with him in order that we might also be glorified with him. A Christian that suffers, the sufferings. And the Apostle Paul says that to Timothy, suffer with me the sufferings of Christ. Fight the good combat. He doesn't say you will be blessed because this or because of that, your life will be over victorious and this and that. No, suffer with me the sufferings of Christ. Let's suffer together. Because together we suffer with Christ, together we will be glorified with Christ. Because we cannot expect, you know, a person that lives expecting glory on this planet, on this earth, it won't see the glory in heaven. Because you expect the glory of man. You expect the glory that will glorify yourself or will glorify others. Or you expect the glory that will have a deep impact in you here, when the glory is there. It's the reward of salvation. It's the real reward of, we are, certainly we see that we fought the good fight, and now I am with the Father for real. For the eternity. This is a spiritual inheritance that comes also from Abraham. But like Abraham, we need to comply with these instructions and obey him as Abraham did. I start the service of the sermon speaking about building my testimony. So this is how you build your testimony. You build your testimony under the instructions that we are the temple of God. And the temple of God that needs to be reconstructed, or constructed, or in many cases, just restored. I was one of the cases, because I was raised in Sunday school. And as I was raised in Sunday school, the Word of God was already within me. I knew already a few verses here and there. I knew that the Bible has 66 books and this and that. Many concepts. I knew the stories of David and this and that. All the basics of the Bible I knew. So when I came when I fell on drugs, I disappeared from God's hand. When God got me back, of course, God started the process of restoration. He started restoring me in the glory that he was expecting. And he's continually, because as we sing many times, he doesn't stop working. We are the ones that say, stop working. Enough is enough. It's painful. It's a sacrifice. It will be always, because we are not perfect. It will be always, because we are sinners. But perseverance, for me, it's the key for everything, especially in Christian life. Perseverance is the key for everything. A person that is able to persevere, it's a person that is able to, like the Apostle Paul, able to say, I finished the race and I kept my faith. I ran the race, I finished it, but I kept the faith. Why? Because he persevered. And he went through things that he never went. Consider this. You are in construction. Consider this. Consider. Allow the Spirit of God to deal with you. There is things that are coming to your life even now as we speak. You are dealing with things within you. You are dealing with things that they belong to you. And with this, I call the worship team to come here, please. You are dealing with things that they are within you. You are dealing with stuff that you don't understand, you don't comprehend. Yet, is the Spirit of God already working in your life? And you need to address that. And you need to understand and discern that there is many things, or most of the things, or 100% of the things that come to you, it's God dealing with you. What verse I quote many times? Romans what? Romans 8, 28. What it says? All things work for good for those that love God and are called according with His purpose. All things work for good for those that love God and are called according with His purpose. Everything that happens, it will work for good. The bad things, the good things, the more or less things, everything, it will work for good if you love Him. And if you understand also that you were called according with the purpose He has for you. I will invite you to stand up, please.